Hi everyone, Aaron here for Zolotech, and today Apple released iOS 15 Beta 8 to developers. This is available now to all developers around the world at the same time that's running the beta program, and hopefully it will be out to public beta testers soon. Last week with Beta 7, it released about the time I released this video, but if it's not out by now, by the time you're watching this, you can expect it at the latest sometime tomorrow. That's what they typically do. Now you'll see this came in at 529.1 megabytes. That's on my iPhone 12 Pro Max. And it was between 400 to 500 megabytes on the iPhone 11 and iPhone 6S Plus. Along with this, Apple also released iPadOS 15 Beta 8 that I have on my 12.9 inch iPad Pro from 2021, along with tvOS 15 Beta 8, watchOS 8 Beta 8, and yesterday they released macOS Monterey Beta 6, so it's a few betas behind, and we'll talk about that maybe in a different video. But let's first talk about the build number and then take a look at what's new. So we'll go to settings, then we'll go to general, then about. Now you can see the build number is 19A5340A. And this particular build ending in an A just means that it's very stable and we're getting closer to a final release. I'll talk about when to expect iOS 15 releasing to the public in a little bit. But as far as new changes and features, the first thing is this version does not have a new modem firmware update. So if you're coming from beta 7 and you are having 4G or 5G or LTE connectivity issues or switching between the different versions, there is no update, at least on the 12 Pro Max. So that is not probably going to be any better than it was before, but so far it's been great for me with the previous few betas. Prior to them updating it is when I had some issues. Now it seems to be working just fine. Now, as far as new features and changes, the first thing is if you're using the iTunes U application, so you have iTunes U installed, they've made a change to the settings. Now, iTunes U is going to be discontinued at the end of 2021, but it was updated either way. So if you go into your settings and then you go down to iTunes U, again, you will need to have this installed. Go to iTunes U. You'll see that it has Siri and search, notifications, cellular data, and sync notes. If we take a look at the previous version with beta 7, it's a little bit different on the left with beta 7, where we don't have cellular and data or cellular data, and notifications has been updated a little bit. This is not a huge change, but it is something worth noting. Now, also, if you're using custom domain aliases in iCloud, this is a new feature. If you're using the new iCloud features, iCloud Plus, and you use a custom domain, you can get that on the website, the custom domain on the beta of iCloud.com. And if you set up a custom domain for email, those aliases are now showing when you go to send an email. This was found by a user on Reddit. So if you're sending an email, that option will be there with the new email address and domain name. Now, there was a change when you go into TV for the first time, there's a new splash screen. So it's nothing huge, but it says Apple Originals and Shared with You. This popped up on every device here, so it's a new splash screen that we're seeing here as well. And along with this, Apple also released an AirTags firmware update. So as far as features, there's not a whole lot going on in beta 8 as we've gotten more and more stable and closer to a final version. I'll talk about resolved issues and remaining bugs in just a moment, but they did release a firmware update for AirTags again. Recently they released one, now they've released another one. And the only way to update this is sort of just let it update. And they've given you the option to see the update in Find My, but there's no way to initiate the update. So if you go into Find My, at the top, you can see the firmware version currently on my AirTag is 1.0.276. There's a new one that is 1.0.291. What it does or specifically why they've updated it is hard to say, but there is an update, so it will update in the background when it can. Now in iPadOS 15 Beta 8, there's no major changes, just the ones I mentioned already, such as going into the Apple TV app, you'll get the same splash screen, and there is no universal control enabled just yet. Now they didn't enable it on the Mac either, although you can enable it using a terminal command and it will work between Macs. But on the iPad, if you go to general and then AirPlay and handoff, turn it off and back on, you'll have keyboard or cursor and keyboard, which we've had for a few betas hinting that it's coming soon, but so far it's not on the iPad. So universal control is not here yet. Hopefully it will be here in the near future. Now, as far as resolved issues or things that they've fixed, they have zero mentioned in this update. That doesn't mean they haven't fixed anything, but there's nothing that they've mentioned specifically that they've fixed in this update. So if you were having issues with Twitter, although Twitter has not crashed on me yet since installing beta 8, that could be a Twitter update. But again, it's still something that we have to give a few days to know if it's going to continue to have issues. But as far as any other resolved issues, I haven't had anyone mention that we have green tint or anything like that, but that doesn't mean it has been resolved since they haven't specifically mentioned it. So there's still some issues that are remaining in this update. In fact, they mentioned 26 known issues or bugs that still remain. And again, that storage bug is still present for some. So if you go into settings and then you go to general, and then you go to your storage, your iPhone storage, some people are seeing excessive use of their storage. You'll see it's showing I'm only using 29.2 gigabytes of 256 gigabytes, and that's not technically accurate. This will recalculate, but it's still an issue for certain apps. So sometimes it shows a much larger number than what I'm actually using. There we go, it filled in. And at the bottom, you can see iOS is using 7.779 gigabytes, and system data is not really using any according to this, but there's odd storage bugs throughout, and many people are still reporting this. So be sure to report that in feedback if you're having that. Banking apps are still going to be an issue for some, depending on your bank, where you're located, and whether or not they've updated their app. But as we get closer to the final version, they can submit their apps with the updated code with iOS 15, and those should be resolved. CarPlay will still be an issue for some. I don't know if this is related to the specific manufacturer, whether that be Honda, Toyota, BMW, Mercedes. If you're having issues with that, I hear more from Honda right now where they're having issues with CarPlay, but right now there still seems to be some issues for some, not everyone though. Now that leads me to, should you install iOS 15 beta 8? And if you're on beta 7, there's not really any reason not to. And even if you're on the public versions, I've said for the last three versions, it seems to be stable enough for most, as long as you have a backup and are aware that you need a computer to go back to a previous version. So if you have those things and you're willing to maybe wipe the device to restore to a previous version, then it's safe to try it out. If not, then I would hold off until the final release. And when to expect iOS 15 releasing to the public? Well, next week I would expect them to send out invites for the iPhone 13 event, with maybe having the event on the 13th or 14th of September. Based on that, we could expect iOS 15 somewhere in the middle or next week in September. So middle of September or the following week, where we would have a final release based off what they do year over year. So we could see iOS 15 then, along with a new Apple event. And then also I would expect iOS 15 beta 9 or release candidate on either next Tuesday or next Wednesday. That's typically what Apple does as they get ready to that final to release that final version to everybody else. So look for that fairly soon. Now, as far as battery life takes a few days to measure. So I'm just going to show you my battery life from beta 7, since it's okay. It's nothing phenomenal, but it seems to be okay depending on who you are. You'll see my battery health is at 94%. The updates don't make this go down at all. They just simply recheck. And this is what it was before for me and has been for the past few versions. And you'll see yesterday I had 2 hours and 23 minutes of screen on time, 5 hours and 40 minutes of screen off time. And today I've had 3 hours and 3 minutes of screen on time, 2 hours and 31 minutes of screen off time. You'll see I've used about 40% of my battery, 30 to 40%, which means if we double or triple this, we're getting 6 to 9 hours of screen on time. That's pretty good, especially for the betas, and I would expect it to be right up there with the 8 to 10 to 12 hours of screen on time by the time it releases to the public. So that seems to be what I would expect. As far as overall performance, the overall performance seems to be pretty smooth. I haven't had any real lockups or anything since installing it. Again, it's brand new, so I'll have to use it for a few days, and I have a follow-up on Sunday I usually do. And this is pretty smooth, just going into the app library. If we go into music, that opened incredibly fast the first time I opened it on a 6S Plus. So it seems to be doing okay. However, the overall Geekbench scores actually are a little bit lower or about the same. So if we take a look at those, you'll see on my iPhone 12 Pro Max, I had 1,590 for single core, 4,058 for multi-core. If we take a look at the history, I ran it a couple different times and got the same scores. So you'll see I'm a little bit lower by 1 point on single core and about almost 70 to 80 lower on multi-core, but this doesn't really show the overall usage of the device. It just gives a general idea. So let's take a look at all of these devices so you can compare what you have. From left to right, you'll see I have the iPad Pro 12.9 from 2021, followed by the iPhone 6S Plus, the iPhone 11, and the iPhone 12 Pro Max. And again, this is just to give you a general idea of what to expect. So with iOS 15 Beta 8, as we get closer to the final release, there's going to be less and less changes, and they're just going to work on bugs from here on out. So there might be some small visual changes. Some people have mentioned visual changes in the app switcher, with maybe some of the corners changed a little bit and where they've moved some of the text, but very minor changes with this update. And once we get to the release candidate, that's sort of locked in until iOS 15.1, where we'll probably see SharePlay re-enabled and things like that. As far as iOS 14.8, I'm thinking at this point, maybe we'll never see one. Some people were saying we should see it already. Maybe we'll see it with just the ability to add security updates, or Apple could have scrapped it altogether. We haven't seen it now. It's possible we could see it this week, but if we don't see it in a couple weeks, maybe we'll never see it. We just don't know at this point. So I'm not sure if we'll see that, but hopefully we'll see something for those that want to stay on iOS 14. But let me know what you're looking most forward to at the upcoming Apple event. And if there's anything else that you found in iOS 15 Beta 8, I'd love to hear from you in the comments below. If you'd like to get your hands on this wallpaper, of course, I'll link it in the description like I normally do. And if you haven't subscribed already, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.